You take me far away under a sycamore trees.
Welcome to Twin Peaks Unwrapped. I'm your host, Ben Durant, and beside me is
Brian Kazaska.
And we have Nathan Lee Miller Foster. He is the wizard rock star who lives in Boston and loves his rock star Lady Beth JJ. He's Freemason out of Orient Lodge in Norwood, Mass., as well as a Scottish Rite Mason out of Valley of Boston, and currently a 7th degree York Rite Mason.
Agnostic and poet. His writing can be found at Occult Fan WordPress, and his music can be found on Bandcamp. For fans of Twin Peaks, he especially recommends you listen to his song, And Now for the Doctor. Finally, you will enjoy catching up to and keeping up with his Six of Swords podcast, which can be found on Apple or Podcast Addict. And all those links will be in the show notes in case you couldn't keep up with all that.
Hi, Nathan Lee. How are you?
Hey, both of you guys. Thank you so much for inviting me on the show. I appreciate your giving me the opportunity to talk about some Twin Peaks.
And I'd love to just really quickly start off, like, how did you get into Twin Peaks? How did you find out about the show?
Oh, my God. besides being kind of like a cultural, like, thing that popped up here and there in The Simpsons, right? Obviously, the famous Homer watching the show going, I have no idea what's going on. We all saw that when we were kids. And, you know, obviously, basically, I saw it when I was it's a really important part of my life. I was going through a lot of transitions, and I was moving to a new school, and I ended up in the basement there at the library downloading stuff from like something or other, or at least finding where some sites. This is 2005 now, okay, July of 2005. 7/7 if you're doing the math. 2 and 5 is 7 in July. So basically, I found it on like some Vimeo or something of the time, and I watched it, and instantly I had found my family. It was so familiar. Like, I couldn't stop watching. I knew this was like speaking to me at a soul level. Wow. So that's how I discovered it. And I've known about it since I was a kid. I think I saw it on TV like for a minute, but the real time was July 2005 when I really got into it, and I watched them all.
So cool. Now, I have known you from Twitter, and your handle is Occult Fan. So are you a fan of the occult?
That's a fair question. I should say no to that.
Yeah.
honest to God, it's such a strange word. And I live such a strange life. Like, I really do believe there's so much more to the material world. I think that someone who's like a materialist is like a blind person in a way. I'm trying really to be polite and just like, you know, not judgmental. It's really hard to, you know, when like, you know, something's true and then someone else doesn't, you're like, or at least, you know, your opinion feels that way.
Yeah.
I'm not agnostic. I wanted to, that's a word called Gnostic, capital G-N-O-S-T-I-C. Gnosis is basically a feeling of knowing or knowing. It's knowing something so that no authority can ever tell you what's true. That has to come from you and your connection to what connects us all. But I'm a fan of Final Fantasy VIII. Why is he saying that? Because in Final Fantasy VIII, there's a weird side quest called the Doom Train side quest, where you're required to collect, quote unquote, according to the game, 666 amount of items and activate it with something called Solomon's Ring. And this is called the Occult Fan side quest. And to get Doom Train, you have to collect these magazines, Occult Fan, and they give you these clues, and you can unlock a powerful ally called Doom Train. And anyway, so in that game, they have the side quest of Occult Fan, and that's where that came from. So Twin Peaks, the band Tool, the Final Fantasy / Zelda series, these things inform my life very deeply at almost a DNA level. And the strangest thing is, and this is going to be a plot recurrent that we will return again and again to, that fiction and reality are not separate items, but on one, what you call a F-O-R-T-E-A-N, Fortean scale, phenomenon. But I'll stop for now because I think that sufficiently answers your question at this time.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love the Final Fantasy. I love Final Fantasy VII myself. 3 is my ultimate favorite one, but, you know.
I did that. That was a hard one to beat, but that ends with like there's that like left this like bunch of land mass that's like above no space, and you have to right. That's the end of three, isn't it?
Yeah, when you're fighting, you're basically falling, right? Is that near the end?
I barely remember. I've played three through. I've played 12 through. I'm a fan of 12 that no one likes, but 8 and 9 are special. That those are co-equals for perfect.
Yeah.
The two Twin Peaks are 8 and 9. And 7's also great, you know, with the whole, what is it, like, you got the Avalanche group and stuff like that. But I couldn't get into it. Some divine providence guided me to play 8, and it really has become a huge integral part of my life's working.
That's pretty cool. And we do have the remaster of 7 coming out, which I'm very excited for.
Do we?
We do. It's really coming out this year.
I know. One day.
Yeah, but, right.
What remakes can we have? At least Twin Peaks is keeping it fresh. I mean, you've seen The Lion King.
I think for this, it's we're going to go off the rails for a minute. But this is like a full remake. Like, it's almost like a brand new game. So I think it's going to be pretty cool.
Okay. I don't know that. That's a fair point. No qualms. I have only love for Final Fantasy. And I will say, shout out to the two best Zelda games, because there's got to be two, apparently. Link's Awakening.
Yes.
Majora's Mask.
Yes, Majora's Mask. Link's Awakening, loosely based off of Twin Peaks.
Precisely. Like, my life is... Like, I feel like... we'll let you decide at the end of this with the pieces and see what happens.
What are things that you connect to with Twin Peaks that maybe, you know, there's, like, deeper things about Twin Peaks that you really grab onto, I guess, or really connect to?
Strangely enough, like, my name and my family names and stuff, like, pop up all throughout the book. Like, my father's name is Douglas, and I grew up in Medway, Massachusetts, which is right next to Milford. And, I mean, that's just one silly example, but it's silly when it's just, like, one of the things. It's like, oh, isn't that cute? But then Nathan Twining, Nathan Lee, I literally opened up my book to page 152 and 153, which mentions Project Grudge, which is actually a song in a Tool album that I'm writing a keep up with me that I'm writing a book about. It's based on the reorganization via the Fibonacci sequence in track order of Lateralis into an album called The Holy Gift, an integral piece in The Holy Gift. The first track on Lateralis, or rather the 8th track on The Holy Gift, is called The Grudge. And it is actually connected to all of this, because the song before that, if you understand that angels, aliens, and ultra dimensionals are the same thing, Peaks will argue this too, that you're going to see that there's a track taken from Art Bell's Coast to Coast, a famous UFO paranormal show, having a guy having a freak out talking about how he's escaping from Area 51.
Yep.
It's called Faaip de Oiad, which is Enochian, the language of the angels as derived by Scryer Edward Kelly via court magician 007 Triangle John Dee, who actually has the rights to the architectural structure in Newport, Rhode Island. We can go there someday if you like. On the equinox is the time to do that. Jim Egan's a cool dude, but John Dee is the architect of the Newport Tower, which is on the flag of Newport. I carry on to say that a lot of different aspects of like the Tool album that I'm writing about, and the Twin Peaks and the UFOs, and how that guy was having a freak out. Basically, he talks about how 9/11 is coming, and that call into Art Bell was on 9/11.
Wow.
So the dangers that are coming, literally in a 4-square-year amount. So what we see is that the guy in the book, the whole thrust of the Holy Gift, the whole reason that's a thing and the reason I'm writing about it, is there's an actual consciousness blueprint in there that can, you know, secularly, without any, like, telling you how to feel about what's inside you, it's a structure that allows you to at least live in a optimized, self-governing manner. All right, so this guy's having a freak out. And then the next track after that in the reordering is called The Grudge, Project Grudge, Aliens, you know, he's talking about. And so it all, I'm loosely putting down some pieces for those with eyes to see. But yeah, I think I've said enough for a minute at least.
Now, I love it. I love the Tool reference here, and that audio of that guy freaking out is very chilling.
My life's in strange like periods for the Tool music itself. In fact, you wouldn't even believe, not for the show, but like it just comes back around. But like, that made me throw my headphones off my head. I literally did that. I'm not kidding. I was terrified. It was a shock.
Yeah, very, very creepy.
Military failure, particularly the Area 51. The disaster's been coming, basically. The military
monsters. The government knows about them. And there's a lot of safe areas in this world that they could begin moving the population to now.
Nathan Lee, I feel like you have a good some good understanding of like symbolism in Twin Peaks and dealing with rituals, and like you seem to have a really good understanding about that. Can you talk a little bit about what you see in Twin Peaks?
Sure. I'll say this quickly too to finish the point about the tool thing. The reason the holy gift is a sacred object versus the structured one that came out of the factory, you know, because think about this, the difference between something that came through the organic pure soul of what we call the internet. That's the holy gift. If it ends with fear and terror, like the first album does, like Lateralis, that is horrible. That's like the definition of evil for some really advanced people, I'd say, is to say that anything has an ending. Hmm. And we all know the worst thing is like in our fantasies, when we're all in our private space, like that fantasy that goes wrong where we end with that, no, you know, like that feeling. That's the terror that man felt. The whole lesson to learn from that is to not take anything too seriously. Hermann Hesse says that seriousness is an accident in the overestimation of the value of time. Eternity is only long enough for a joke. So if you're cool and you don't wear the grudge like a crown and you learn to let that go, whatever that ethereal lesson's telling you, you just go right past that. That's not the end. You skate on forward. You keep flowing on your jazz. So you were asking me about symbolism, and that's a way of thinking in symbolic languages, to think laterally, which is one of the lessons of Lateralis. And lateral to us is a twin peak, isn't it? Yes, it is.
Yep.
And it has to do with Alice in Wonderland and Through the Looking Glass. These are continual stories that are told by a different ways of expressing the subtle or the occult or the esoteric traditions that have run throughout humanity in our different iterations throughout our history, whether or not actual human evolution is indeed how that works or not. It seems to be that there is a mystical functioning that different parts of humans throughout the ages, different, you know, parts meaning different like traditions of wisdom, have written about similar concurrent frequencies that appear over and over again in the form of events, in the form of behaviors, in the form of felt meanings. Mm-hmm. And these archetypes are basically a language that the reason we love Twin Peaks is because they speak to us straight through it. They speak to us in the lover's tongue.
You were recently on, or actually, you were on another podcast when Twin Peaks was just about to come on. Season 3 is about to start. Was it a culture yeah, podcast?
It's Ryan Peverly. I love Ryan.
Yeah, it's really cool. So the show, I don't think, had actually come back. It was just about to come back. So do you get to see season 3? Have you got to take that in?
This is the reason my girlfriend can't listen to this episode yet, because we're actually reading Secret History right now. We're doing Files. We're on season 9. We just watched this gets wild quickly, because you guys think that we're talking about fiction, but you're about to realize that David Lynch is casting a huge spell, and fiction crosses over to reality. The two peaks are what you think is fiction and what you think is your reality. And you're about to see Jupiter and Saturn align, so to speak. But anyway, get ready. So anyways, the point is that he and I were talking about all the stuff before that. I started to watch the third season, and stuff's like, it's ridiculous. Like, the first time you watch it, you're like, this isn't my beautiful house. This isn't my beautiful Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh my God, this is, and I just needed to catch up. And you realize that in the third season, it's TPTR. And if you look at one of the core important aspects of the calendar, because this all has to do with time and cycles and manifestation. If you look at that's obviously what, the 22nd of March, right? It's all the 3 months, 3, 6, 9, and 12, 1 and 2 is 3. Hmm. So that's where you have your cross points, Christmas, the summer height, and, you know, the equinoxes. So when you look at the point of the equinox, of the fall equinox, which is significant for several reasons, but we carry on later, you have Virgo on one side and Scorpio on the other side. Both of those are supremely, well, they're all magical, but look at the TP, and you have the M Virgo. You have the lady crossing her legs. Then if you look at the R, it's now the other side of that equal perfect balance of Libra, and it's the sign of Scorpio. And that's why it's Twin Peaks, the return, because the R is the P with the penis coming out, just looking at it purely from a phallic perspective.
So, wow.
Yeah, no, there's so much going on here. Like, it's good. I'm not even going to begin to scratch more than a surface. Like, people who are into Twin Peaks should be getting their magic game up right now, because real change is coming. You know, I mean, believe it or not, what do I know? What do I know?
Man, I love it.
And
love
so are you still, did you say you're just on part 9 right now, or did you finish season 3?
Oh, I finished 3. I've seen it a few times.
Oh, okay, cool, cool.
Yeah, one of the most brutal moments when that Polish accountant comes.
Yeah.
But David, I'm going to say, there's some magic here. You got to understand that, like, while we're all being taught that everyone's this or that, different traditions have special powers that are unique to those traditions, including Polish people. Polish people have a very special thing about them. And that's why he chose a Polish accountant, not just because it looks like Polish or because it's North Pole or anything like that. But there's always codes within codes within codes. And that's one that really sticks out to me, that Polish accountant. Of course, Inland Empire, there's all the Polish people, and he has the... So there's something mystical going on there. But yeah, Twin Peaks Season 3, I'm glad I was able to express that idea about the very fact of the TP and the TR. Not to mention, we see all the Saturn in the show with the lamp, and it was Saturn's return. So that's another reason that's Twin Peaks, the return.
Wow.
That's pretty good. I liked it a lot. That's really cool.
And by the way, that song, The Grudge, that we started off with, guys, we're being guided tonight. I'm just telling you, I'm not, this is real. We're being guided by higher forces. The song that I started off talking about, The Grudge, here's the lyrics. Saturn comes back around.
Yeah.
I like it. I like it a lot. This is great.
Well, it's like I said, for those with eyes to see, and for other people, it's silly and overwhelming. And it's like, I don't know which side of the boat I'd rather be on, but I'd rather know what's going on and catch up with my emotions rather than being left in the dark.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think of, like, I mean, there's so many incredible, like, imagery in the season 3. I think about the atomic bomb. And
episode 8.
I mean, episode 8. I think I've said this to Mark Frost, but it seems to me like there was some kind of, like, ritual of, or something that kind of, like, opened up the door so that, like, we could have the experiment and Bob come out, and that maybe there's some kind of ritual thing going on regarding the Trinity bomb.
I mean, where do I even begin? Mark Frost is someone – I'm a Miller Foster. Mark Frost is someone who I would love to shoot the breeze with and speak as magicians, or at least as people who are concerned with the reality. I don't know what's really – I don't know what their aim is. I like to assume that they're on the side of the White Lodge. Because, you know, we're just going to go straight there right now. This is my opinion. But I think that there actually always really has been spiritual, you know, back and forths. And ultimately, maybe the White Lodge is just a way of seeing the world with courage and nobility and kindness and compassion. Like, you know, fix your heart or die, kind of. But what kind of compassionate person would tell... So complicated as life is, I really do think that there are White Lodges and Black Lodges. It's not an accident. How many other known Freemasons have you had on your show?
None.
You're the I don't first. Know. Yeah, I don't know.
It's the time.
They haven't shared it with us.
Yeah.
Well, it's different. Like, my generation's a bit, I don't know. It's the time for this. It is completely the time for the, so we open up and we see Meriwether Lewis's bloodied Masonic apron, right? In the Twin Secret History.
Yeah.
What's a full fledged Masonic apron doing in this book, right? So you bring up Mark Frost. What's that doing in there, right? What's the overwhelming or overall intention behind that?
Right.
And again, Mark's being led by other forces too, I'm sure. We're just humans. There's so much more than we.
I still think about, like, at the end of season 3 with Diane and Cooper having sex, that maybe they were having a sex ritual. I don't know. Like, they have this act. They don't seem very comfortable. And then Cooper wakes up and he's in a different time. He's in a different
place.
Hotel,
everywhere.
Place.
Yeah.
Diane's not there.
He's a different person. He's now shooting people kind of like more coldly and throwing the gun prior. So he's not even, let's like be careful with magic because it will change you. Yeah. Look. And if it changes you, does it change the world around you? If you change, does the dimension change? Is it, you know, so, I mean, I think that there's a lot going on that's way above my pay grade. I'm just a low level owl, so to speak. That's an Appleseed cast title. It's the only reason I use that phrase. But I think that it's important to realize that if there is a cycle of history coming around, when things just kind of like get really intense or something like that, it would behoove people who are interested in not having a total freak out, shut down life end to like figure out how to strengthen themselves spiritually. I'll actually say it like this. Hunter S. Thompson, when the going gets weird, the weird turn pro.
Mm-hmm.
It's weird.
It is kind of a breakdown at the end with Carrie Page.
Well, that's the whole point, is that they're trying to show you that, like, there will be real changes. I think that's what I was trying to say by saying that.
Yeah.
Even though it seems like it's just a television show, and that's fine. I mean, again. But, you know, there's books that people write, and entire countries base their philosophies off it, if you get what I'm saying.
Right, right.
Not
yeah.
to point at any one book or anything. But, you know, people, that's, what is reality? Can you even tell me where you guys came from?
Mm. No? You've mentioned a couple times, Nathan Lee, about magicians. And I really felt like Cooper clearly became a magician if he wasn't always a magician. But, like, he's in the red room and he just waves his hand and is opening up the curtains by the movement of his hand. And I think that was, like, first time where it seems like he's clearly is a magician.
Yeah, because the Twin Peaks tarot deck that they made a couple of years ago, like, unofficial, whatever, has Cooper as a magician, I believe. Has
I didn't remember that. That's wow. really cool.
It was a cool deck. Yeah, the guy's a neat guy.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, in Garland Briggs is obviously the Hierophant. And if you guys aren't familiar with fellow Bostonian Christopher Loring Knowles, K-N-O-W-L-E-S, the Knowles is not what he seems, of The Secret Sun, you guys want to check out his work. He's got a lot of cool stuff to say about, like, the Cocteau twins, who David Lynch was huge into. In fact, Isabella Rossellini is singing in place of Liz Fraser. And if you look at Liz Fraser, well, all of this crazy ritualistic, you know, art is realer than reality stuff really comes into focus down that thread. But I really feel like what I'm trying to emphasize something here tonight, that this is not just a television show. And it, incredible enough as it came back in 25 years, as it told you it would. So it's like, listen to the wisdom when it speaks, I guess. And but say some more questions, because I'm going in a direction with this. We'll get around to it.
So Nathan Lee, do you think we saw the White Lodge?
Do you remember the fireman when he's showing floating in the room there, the grayscale room? With the
right,
gold?
Right.
I believe that's an indication of a White Lodge. I've seen other people say that, and it just made sense.
It does. It makes a lot of
sense. Yeah, for season three, yes. I do agree there. Like, yeah. I was just wondering, in the original series,
right.
I don't think we ever saw anything indicated.
Dale failed, and that's the entire point about, like,
that's true.
In certain, like, so Danny Carey of Tool, you can go to dannycarey.org/library, and you'll see all, like, a bunch of magic books. These different books also inform the series, like, to the point where that weird, like, endless ocean of purple, that's called the Mauve Zone.
Really?
Of the OTO, the Ordo Templi Orientis, the Order of Eastern Templars, of whom we will get into the television show on Amazon called Hellier at some point. So make sure we do touch on that, because that's actually at the crux of the reality crossover. And the cats who make Hellier are huge Twin Peaks X-Files dudes. In fact, Twin Peaks and X-Files both pop up in Hellier.
Oh wow.
Yeah. It's a show about people who go out to hunt goblins in the first season, and there's all sorts of esoteric stuff. And then the second season, it gets even weirder. And I guarantee this term is the scourge of existence for magicians at this point, but it's called, Carl Jung called it synchronicity. And you're going to start experiencing, like, unexplainable but totally meaningful coincidences that should not be able to happen on a physical level, as if, like, in philosophy, we talk about the billiard balls. But, like, you actually can feel, like, on the higher levels of subtle intelligences, or whatever we call the upper levels of manifestation, where we cannot see things happening and time moves at a different rate and pace. We're slower down here because we're denser. Things are moved around up there, and then we are down here living our lives thinking that we're doing things, when it's really like, oh, that alpaca just walked in and Cooper didn't, or, you know, McLaughlin didn't smile.
Yep.
Well, your wife just happened to meet you at the coffee shop. Like, things happen.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I did start watching Hellyard. You just reminded me. And yes, that I didn't know there was a second season. I haven't finished Hellyard, but my God, I didn't know, like, there were the mines. Correct me if I'm wrong, but the mines held these creatures that were actually, like, Ben, I don't think Ben knows what I'm talking about.
I have no idea what this
is.
These
creatures supposedly were terrorizing people who lived off these mine shaft areas. And this one guy was sending information
to David Chrysta.
Yeah, yeah. He's sending, like, he's showing photos and pictures and all this stuff, and then he leaves, and the people there, the documentarians decide, and they're into supernatural. They decide, hey, we're going to follow this up and take this seriously. But it's a great series. It really is.
As you said series, I wrote the word series. It's the X series by a Boston journalist at a Cambridge named Dark Journalist.
Yep.
It was named Daniel List, but he's been doing the lion's, the yeoman's work of breaking down certain, you know, they like to call BS on the fake UFO people, and they try to support the real people, is basically the long and short of it. One of their preferred people is named Richard Dolan. Richard Dolan published a book by author Mike Cleland. If you guys aren't familiar with Mike Cleland, he wrote a book called The Messengers, all about how aliens or interdimensionals or ultra-dimensionals disguise themselves as owls. And this is real deal spiritual stuff. Mike Cleland, you'll want to look into. But to cycle back around to Hellier, there's a magician who used to be in the OTO, which I mentioned, and his name is Alan Greenfield. And you can actually look up an interview with him and Paul Weston on a show by Frank Zero and Steve Snyder called The Farm. And you can hear a lot more about the recent implications of the fallout of what's been happening.
Really?
In short, it's a ritual that's bringing fiction into reality. And that's why Twin Peaks is tied into this. And I've got more to say, but let's hope I can say at least the necessary things this evening. I really want to serve the overall forward momentum of the White Lodge. I literally identify as a White Lodge dweller. It's like in this weird world of ours, I identify as a furry, like this, that, the other. I identify as a White Lodge dweller. I identify as someone who wants to ultimately, like, live as quote-unquote Christ-like. I always had a problem with, like, people like, you know, let him do it. I'm like, no, you gotta be good to people. That's a lesson.
Yeah, it's true.
But that's what I'm saying. I'm a fan of the show called No Agenda. It's a podcast in the morning, if you're listening. Thank you for your coverage. But, I have a title on that show as a knight, and it's, let's see if I can see this, Sir Nathan Lee Miller Foster, Chaotic Good Knight of the White Lodge, Blue Orchid of the Gold Heart Mountaintop Queen Directory, Elfstone and Bearer of the Sword Reforged. That's my title. You heard the White Lodge in there, so I...
Yeah.
I love it.
They got another knight on the show from No Agenda, who's Sir something of Twin Peaks.
I just like the phrase White Lodge Dweller. I think that's great. I love it. That's pretty cool.
And Nathan Lee,
go ahead. Sorry.
I'm kind of moving on. Like, what is your thoughts about the owls and what they play in? Especially, I think about season two. They're not in it as quite as much in season three. I like to think that maybe they're that's where Bob and Mike can either turn into, or their souls go into the owls. Or what do you make of these owls? The owls are not what they seem.
Yeah, exactly. I think you said a few important things there. Oh my God, that's what it is? Sorry, I'm just having a realization about the sigil on Twin Peaks. Let me get back to your owl thing in a second. But if you see how it's like a weird diamond and then the two peaks coming out and it looks like a little owl flying, right? That one?
Yeah.
I like to say when Jupiter, I have written, I'll send you guys this and you can put the picture up on your show notes if people are interested just to see. But I have this thing permanently written on my daily whiteboard, you know, a calendar. It has half calendar, half whiteboard.
Yeah.
And on it, it says when Jupiter and Saturn align, it forms an X. These are the Twin Peaks. So I'm seeing that the form of an X, when you move it out forward, it becomes a diamond like this. And we're seeing the repetition of the pattern. Also, that looks analogous in the Triforce language, the Trinity. So again, that comes back to what was the Trinity bomb at White Sands? Was Jack Parsons actually launching rockets into space? Can you go past the Van Halen radiation belt? Or is that all a lie? Cough, cough, cough. Or are what we're talking about is stars and things like aliens and going to space? Is that actually utilizing a particular explosion of energy on one level to rip open a dimensional veil, because things don't work like rocks up at that level of density. They actually get more mystical, or they get more ethereal. So I'm just saying, what was Jack Parsons, and who's obviously in the book, and I can't even tell you, like, people accuse me of being the reincarnation of Aleister Crowley or connect me with Jack Parsons, and all three of us are Libras, but it's just this really weird series of events that it does seem like connected somehow to the line of magic that they did. And with that, I'll say 93 93 and let you guys ask another question.
What did you have any thoughts about the owls and what they why they're part of the show? Or
93 again to the third. And yes, the owls are obviously some kind of possessable animal, or at least a shape-shifting animal, associated with the Roman goddess Minerva. They have, you know, they're a predator bird. They can see at night. They can turn their direction in 360 degrees. Hmm. The all-seeing eye is well established as an analogous totem. Yeah, they're probably interdimensionals, or showing at least like the ability for the interdimensional to hunt. You know, in the land of the blind, a one-eyed man is king. So in the land of dumbed-down sapiens who watch YouTube, who aren't connected to their spirituality, you know, we're all hedgehogs to their feast, and we can't even curl up in a ball. So I don't know. I think they are both good and bad, but I think they're a vehicle that is for whatever we call aliens.
Mm.
Yeah. In one sense, I don't think that's all they are.
Right.
Right.
And that you did remind me, because it was the secret history of Twin Peaks, that I think if you have to wear your red and blue glasses.
3D
glasses or something, but I think it showed it as an owl, or it showed it as an alien.
Yes.
I had forgotten that.
It's very clear. It's not – you don't need to use any woo-woo. You can just look at it and you can see it's an image overload.
Yeah.
That's important because the guy who Alan Greenfield writes several books called The Secret Cipher of the Men in Black and Secret Cipher of the Ufonauts. And he's talking about the Men in Black and that and owls and how these are all interdimensionally related. I think that's what these Men in Black are also. I don't know. Something's blocking me from saying something right now. It feels strange. Please continue. But it's weird.
It's funny you brought Men in Black, because I was just thinking about the Men in Black when you were talking like 10 minutes ago about the alien stuff. Because those people were always seemed, when people talk about what they saw, was very owl-like, I guess, kind of like a pale person, very white, big eyes. You could associate with those an owl, maybe.
Hmm.
It's true. You could. Maybe that's just like they have really good vision or something. It's like one of those like piecing down the archetypes or something, paring it down so it just comes across that way. But yeah, I don't know. The Men in Black are likely interdimensional, highly advanced magicians, for lack of a better word.
Mm.
I don't know. I'll tell you this. I hope that I come across as a really honest and genuine and sweet and real person who like,
you do.
Doesn't.
Yeah.
I cut straight to the core though. I want to know who you are, and I am. This matters to me. Integrity. Mm-hmm. So I have a group of weirdos that I love dearly. I'm part of it's not MUFON, but I'm part of a UFO group that, long story short, I found an airborne patch and a sword that looks just like the Bookhouse Boy sword, but two slashes of electricity going through it.
Wow.
In a wooded patch of forest. So it was electric / forest. So it was combining the two. And I keep that airborne in here because the UFO group I'm a member of is similar to that concept in a way, but I found the patch in the foresty area, and 5 minutes later I get this guy yelling at me from across the street while I'm walking this dog named Shadow, listening to an episode about the Women in Black, and this guy basically ropes me into this UFO group. Long story short, it's led by people who were friends with my family as a child, who used to spend time at my house. And they worked with my father.
Wow.
Before my father was a pastor. My father, I'm the son of a preacher man and a medieval scholar. That's my mom. That's why she named my brother Jeffrey Niles. And I'm saying that for the sake of anyone listening to this, listening to the majesty of the strangeness of my family's name, going back to like Harry Leroy. Yes, my grandfather was Harry Truman. And Linda is my mother's, Linda Lee. So you got Linda and Harry there and Doug. Like, pretty much all of my family's names start showing up throughout the series. And I'm talking about the borderlines between fiction and reality here. It's a very important thing to grasp, because these Men in Black thing, they're fake, right?
Hmm. Yeah. Maybe.
Maybe.
I don't have answers, but, like, the whole point is about truth. So I found this thing. Turns out I end up in this UFO group. They were working on bows back in the 70s, apparently. Like, on the LD. I think it's safe to say now. I might get back to you and say, please cut that part out. I might not.
Yeah.
But working on some weird stuff at Bose, not just like speakers and sounds, but if you understand what sound is, this is the sound of my voice. You know, if you understand what sound is, it's everything. Sword in the stone, my friends, is the word in the tone. It's not what you said. It's
how you said it.
Yeah, the word in the tone. Yeah. So anyway, yeah, sound is everything. You know, it's like a twin peak. What's a peak? It's a vibration on a wavelength scale. A peak is a representation of the extremes. What is it? It's the extreme of utmost. You got two of them, doubles are good. That means it's relevant and real in both dimensions, if we're talking about an actual parallel universe.
Yeah, and there's ripples of that in season three. Different, we don't know where we are.
Right. And I'm glad you went there because I wanted to go there to some degree. We have this whole thing of dreams in the series, but then we seem to have other worlds. People have met each other through dreams like Laura and Cooper, and yet then they meet each other together in, you know, that they're somehow able to be in the same place. And I'm just fascinated by that. And I don't really have an answer of like what is real and what isn't.
I have really direct, like, super, this just happened. Like, I just got told this in an hour or two ago. All names cleared to protect the guilty, right? But, yeah, I run an Invisibles reading group. There's a comic book by Grant Morrison called The Invisibles.
Yes. Familiar? Yes. Yep.
All right. Great. If you're interested, we're going to be running it at least one more time. We began it on 11/11 at 11/11 p.m. because it's how I roll. In fact, 11/11, every time someone says something about 11/11 or looks at it and thinks about it, it actually charges me. It's weird. But anyway, yeah, no, it's a good thing.
Yeah.
I got a good thing going. But the point is, let's see. Take me back to where I was just about to say.
We were talking about dreams and planes and.
Yeah, well, I started Invisibles on 11/11. As an aside, the dude who made Hellier, turns out we're born in the same year. The year it's about to be Chinese-wise, which is the year of the rat. We are both born in the year of the wood rat, and Master Splinter is a wood rat, and wood rat Master Splinter was popularized in the year of the rat of the wood, because that's how these things work. And again, Twin Peaks did that with I'll See You in 25 Years. These are all the way. So I started the group. Turns out that the guy who makes Hellier's birthday is on 11/11, and it turns out that his wife gave him a copy of The Invisibles for Christmas. It was just a whole bunch of, and we started it again on his birthday unknowingly.
Huh.
So, these are the people who made Hellier. But so one of my members in my Invisibles group, our Invisibles group, we were like joking about meeting each other in the astral planes, and then stuff happened. And we, you know, like, apparently I have a really cool superpower that I'm not going to come right out and say, but like, holy crap. And I know how that sounds to like the lay observer. But yeah, no, I think stuff's, you know, you should with all, you know, your mind's fragile in a way, you know, the subconscious can easily swallow you whole if you're not learning how to swim like Tool admonished us in their previous album. So, you know, take caution, but remember, there's no way else. You can't just spin in a cycle. You'll either spiral in a circle or you'll spiral downwards. The real trick to life, the one out of the three, is to spiral upwards, always. Just like in the new Fear Inoculum art, Alex Gray kind of expands it to showing the upward spiral. Bringing it back around to the dream thing, though, basically, you can meet your friends in the dream world.
You know, it's interesting you brought that up, because in high school, I had some friends who, I don't know what they were discussing, but I remember them saying, I will see you in my dreams. I thought they're joking.
Bobby Briggs literally said that to Norma.
Right.
She's like, I'll see you in my dreams. Yeah.
But I'll see you first.
Right.
Right. But they the next day they were laughing, giggling that
you weren't part of it. I guess you weren't.
I wasn't. But they did, and they were like connected in a way that, like, to them it happened. And I didn't question it, but I remember it to this day. Also, it kind of reminds me a little bit of something, like I would have sleep paralysis a lot. And yep. When I read about that, which is kind of scary stuff, it's when you probably know about this, Nathan Lee, when you go to sleep, supposedly your energy or whatever have you, leaves your body. And I would have sleep paralysis where I would wake up, but I couldn't breathe. I felt like someone was sitting on my chest. I thought, like, I felt like I was dying. And when I looked up, it's your body wakes up before your energy comes back. And it's like, that's what they would say sleep paralysis would be. And it's happened to me a few times, and it's scary.
They also call that a hag attack. I think we need to start stepping back. Yeah, I will come out and say this because I've said it on other shows. I've been picked up by forces and thrown against the wall.
Wow.
I have been picked up. I don't need to say it again. That's the true true. Yeah, it's just weird, you know. I mean, it really feels like, for what it's worth, I'm like a real life character in Twin Peaks.
Totally.
I don't mean this. I wasn't even planning on. Good catch my language. I wasn't even planning on saying that. I kind of do a thing. I have a Pisces rising, and Pisces is mutable water. Remember, there's four elements. That means there's three possible types if you use 12. So there's beginning, middle, and end. End is very malleable because that's the time when things are changing. So water that's malleable is like known as the super psychic sign. Mm. And when you've got a sun sign, a moon sign, your moon's what you are inside, basically. Your sun's what the world sees you. But your rising sign, where the horizon is, that's why you need to know your time and place. And that's why it's all kaput without it, because that will set your houses, which determines which of the 12 signs then get filtered through what they call houses. The first house is like yourself. The 10th is like your career. 11th is your house of friends. So you can see why if you had your house of friends on this one, it would be different if you had it on this one. Hmm. But anyways, super psychic sign, the Pisces I have, the rising. So I'm connected between both worlds. My feet literally are in one, in the heavens and the earth. Like, it's kind of what I'm here for. Hmm. So I understand what Lynch and Frost are doing, like, intimately. Hmm. And I honestly would, you know, if I were given the grace to speak with them, like my brother Freemason Mitch Horowitz, he got to interview David. And wow. I just think that there would be some fruitful discussions if I could be humble enough to listen, and if they took my points. Both of those men would be a godsend to be able to converse with as far as my spiritual understanding of the reality would go. And I could help others, I think, if I did some good stuff with that. That's my whole point.
Yeah.
Very cool. It's interesting to see, like, how Mark Frost and David Lynch are. I think of Mark Frost very much into rituals and mythology and symbols. But you do have David Lynch, who is very much into numbers, and he sees numbers in everything he does, and he seems very... Yeah, he definitely has a different perspective. He's very much into dreams, Lynch, and stuff like that. So it's interesting to see these two very different men, and yet they can have some similarities and some things that they can bring together to bring Twin Peaks.
Well, it's kind of like the two of you guys, you know? And it's like with like for me, especially in my chart, the way it's like, I don't I'm crap by myself. Like, I will explode. And if I have a partner or someone to work with, like, you can't stop us. It's kind of like... You don't get everything in life. You can't. Right. No one gets, you know, even the king goes mad. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I just wanted to make a point. Then we can come back around to the Frost and Lynch, because I think there's some juicy stuff in there. But I'm glad. Dude, the freaking chapter's called The Way of the Wizard. Of course it is. I'm about to have a moment here. The book, The Secret History of Twin Peaks, was surely inspired by a man with a twin name. That is Jonathan Black or Mark Booth. Mark Booth wrote The Secret History of the World. Gentlemen, are you familiar?
I don't know if I am.
No.
I'm going to read to you from page 178, because this without a doubt went into the creation of Twin Peaks. So Peakies, get your copies. And go on to Twitter and say nice things to Mr. Jonathan Black. Say that the occult fan person said the nice things, and then he'll be extra happy. Double niceness. Twin love. Fix your heart or die. Twin love. So on page 178, actually, here it is. Seeing things at night. I was looking for this page while you were talking. Because it has the pictures of the night hags and different depictions throughout history. This is 1904 by Maxfield Frederick Parrish. So if you look, I can send you guys these like later if you want to add them to the show notes. But on the next page is one of the most important pages between more pictures of hag attacks, which I was trying to get to. So actually, this is like totally fate right now. Meeting of contemporary secret society in the woods in West Sussex, England. Paracelsus said, "It is as necessary to learn evil things as good, for who can know what is good without learning what is evil? It is sometimes supposed that all secret societies engage in commerce with evil spirits. However, historically significant secret societies, such as the Rosicrucians, which I am a Rosicrucian, and the Freemasons, you already know I am, acknowledge the dark side only in order to combat it." That's a sub-note in this illustrated secret history of the world, which undoubtedly impacted Mark Frost, and we have Freemasons in the actual secret history of Twin Peaks. So I'd like to let you gentlemen think about that for a second.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course, you know where my mind goes? Is my mind then goes to the Bookhouse Boys. Like, it's almost like the Bookhouse Boys could have been Masons, or they're definitely in this group and secret society. And
You guys are okay. I like you guys. I like you guys. You guys are A-okay. Yeah, man. That's some important stuff to talk about, because I actually have – I am uniquely situated to speak this information. If you care to allow me to elaborate before we talk a little bit about the Mark Frost and
sure.
such, there's 2 days in the year that are super important. You're not really traditionally a Freemason is only considered a Freemason. And again, obviously, I'm not going to say anything that you can't – I'm just telling you some obvious stuff here. A Freemason is not really considered a Freemason if he doesn't observe the days of the Holy Saints John. I knew this like when I was a kid for some reason. Hmm. That's June 24th. That's St. John Day in the summer. I want to say it's the Baptist, but now I'm being horrible. I can't remember which one's Evangelist and Baptist on the moment, because June 24th is UFO Day also, because Masonry and ultra-dimensionals definitely aren't connected, says Alan Greenfield, wink. I'm not just in the clans. For any of my brethren, companions, or princes listening, like, it's just an opinion, and you guys know that it's an important thing that's at this period of history. Basically, America was started 250 years ago in 2026, right?
Yes.
That's not a fair thing, I guess. Yes, the answer is yes.
Yes.
Yeah, and. While I pull this up, I delivered a speech at my Masonic Lodge in Norwood, Mass., as I mentioned, Orient Lodge. I love my brethren there. I was kind of trailing off before talking to all my brethren listening. Guys, I hope you're enjoying the show. So that's what I was going to say there. But I ended up giving a speech that was based off of a speech that was given. Now, why did I start by saying that there's a Feast of St. John? Because there's also one in December on the 27th. This is one that is always a huge, huge, huge draw. We had a new Grand Master of Masons in Massachusetts installed this year. He is the highest position in Massachusetts Masonry, each Masonic body being independent within the state that it is in its own jurisdiction. That being said, we got a new head of Masonry in our state, and there was, of course, different keynote addresses given. The most important one, of course, is the keynote itself, and this was given by Brother Akram R. Elias. He's the past Grand Master, again, Grand Master, right, of the Grand Lodge of Washington, D.C. So he's the head of the head lodge in the head of the country.
Wow.
And by the way, if you look at a Masonic lodge, actually, we'll get around to that. So, but I'm not going to read you the entire speech that he gave. I am fairly sure that I don't even need to... we'll see about supplying it to you, but I'm going to read to you briefly from the reflections that I gave on the speech that he said. And the necessary parts, I will simply condense down to, let's say, you know, I'm gonna share right now what was said in the keynote speech and bring it down to three sentences. And if you guys have any questions, I'll elaborate. But let's keep it really, mercifully brief. And the three statements that our brother made were these. My dear brethren, America and Freemasonry are mystically tied through an invisible cable toe that a true initiate fully understands. Therefore, what happens to America the day after 2026 is of the utmost concern to us Freemasons. For the celebration to be meaningful, Americans must pause and reconnect with the essence of the capital G and capital E great experiment. Whence came you, America? And whence came we as entered apprentice Masons? Does America have free, enlightened, and engaged citizens, capital C, citizens, to make the experiment work? Welcome to the true legacy of Freemasonry.
Huh.
In that speech, he talked about esoterics and esoterics, and these are important times we're living in right now, basically, and I don't think it's any accident that there's aprons in this book. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I
don't, yeah.
We're at an interesting period in history where we could, things can always go both ways. You know, that point in the relationship where you or your girlfriend, if you're still with her, it's because you guys chose to get along, or it's because you chose to go over the edge. You know, there's stuff that happens. And as societies, as above, so below. So if we're heading towards a quote unquote crisis point, you know, when the veils will allow you only into that wooded area with the sycamore trees only once or whenever. Why is that? Why? Because the quality of the energies change. People go crazy on the full moon. That's a microcosmic. What if the whole thing's a volcano of crazy full moons? Mm-hmm. So when I'm saying, yeah. So again, when you teach yourself how to control your own selves, you don't get externally controlled. And there's a huge lesson, because as the weather of the space weather waxes and wanes, great Cocteau Twins song, as it waxes and wanes, it's going to impact us greater or lesser. And wouldn't you think it to be the most responsible, independent thing a person could do to overcome their susceptibility to external forces governing them versus their own self-control within? And that's what the Twin Peaks of America and Freemasonry are.
Wow. You tied that up pretty good there. You tied it together, like, and you could see that with the lodges and then with Major Briggs and the Bookhouse Boys and all that.
There's secrets and there's a history and there's
secret societies. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
I love
it. There's no accident that I'm here tonight. I am of my own volition speaking with you guys, having a great conversation with people who love the best show ever. I mean, that's not a question here.
Yeah.
And at the same time, things happen that make life so much better. And sometimes it's a weird spiritual thing.
Mm.
You can't quite explain it. Just like you can't quite explain mom's peaks and dad's peaks. You know, Jupiter and Saturn came together. And, well, ideally, right? Wink, wink. But they came together and now we're here. So the Holy Trinity, you know, it's like Mozart said in the Magic Flute, Brother Mozart. He said, man, und Weib, you know, man and woman, and then the child. Those are the three things that keep the world going. I'll say this. To finish this point succinctly enough, to wrap it up like a Masonic apron almost, you would say that Alex Gray's newest artwork in Fear Inoculum, which is a hugely important album, released the day after the singer's birthday that I mentioned, Elizabeth Fraser, so that's August 30th, on his hyperstellium in Virgo, the mutable earth element, mutable change on the physical level. I know I'm throwing stuff, don't worry about it. That's for people who are into this. That's like inside baseball stuff. But so on the tool artwork, it shows these, it's basically talking about the DNA, right? The actual DNA that's in us right now, that holographic stuff, whatever it is, he's showing the Olympic torch built out of a DNA stalk, metaphorically saying, what happens with the Olympic torch? It's they run with it forward and it's a celebration and it never goes out. You can't ever let it go out. Yeah.
The spirit.
Yes. It continues.
So we need, that's like literally when the Tool, listen to the Tool album Fear Inoculum. It's meant to be listened as an entire seven song set. If you're listening to the physical, it's literally a movie. And some of the lessons it talks about there, because it is lessons, like for what it's worth, there's interdimensionals working with Tool, hands down. The owls are working with Tool, if you will. I think that talks about calling us to, you know, to arms and order. Or there's all these, I could go down and explain why these concepts are super relevant to what we're saying, but ultimately right now what's really important is it's trying to teach a very no BS spiritual lesson in that album. And don't forget that The Tempest was Shakespeare's final play and it was about a magician.
Oh, very true.
The seven's relevant. If you look at Capricorn and Cancer, I'm just going to, I know I'm throwing stuff at you. Like, this has just become like occult blah, but honestly, it's kind of how the mind works at times. And by the way, the difference between Capricorn and Cancer, the soul gate of entrance and the soul gate of exit, is a seven. Because the 76ers, or 1776, is the Capricorn, and a Cancer is a 69. David Bowie, a Capricorn, died of cancer at 69 because he actually... He definitely really died. He's not just like retired publicly.
Right.
Yeah. Isn't that crazy?
And no hex, right? Whatever.
So Nathan Lee, we don't have a lot more time with you, but I'd love, is there anything else you want to share with us before we do have to end the show?
You know, I feel like I've done a really good job addressing a lot of the key points I wanted to make. I wanted to try to get to the hot spots of like some of the more seriously accessible and obviously important metaphors that the show presents to us, like that whole thing about Jupiter and Saturn aligning. In our real world, quote unquote, there's going to be a Jupiter Saturn conjunction coming up at the end of 2020, which is what, two twos, two peaks?
Wow.
And don't forget that 10 itself as a number isn't really a number, it's a measurement of expansion or contraction. So to intensify, that's why you tens things. X is the multiplication, and it's a 10 as well. What else can we throw in here? Because when it's multiplying, it's like the children multiplying. There's again the Jupiter and Saturn, that force of Jupiter is expansion. Remember the ghost of Christmas past. Jollity, joy. Jupiter, the bringer of joy by Holst. And then you look at Saturn, the future, the, you know, the death, the scythe, the old man of New Year. And that's restriction. You put a ring around your beloved's finger because you love them so much and you're going to fit the custom of restriction. Hmm. That ring binds them. To thee I now wed. To thee you are bound. So Saturn's binding, Jupiter's expanding. That sounds like oil and water, right? So what perfect opposites? Conjunct you ad oppositorum. The singer of James Keen and Maynard of Tool has a union of, what is the name of your book? It's right here. A perfect union of contrary things.
Hmm.
So, you know, it's when two opposites come together that you get a reaction and then you get a third thing. That's alchemy. I guess the last thing I want to talk about is Lodge 49. If any Lodge 49 nerds are out there, or anyone who's actually like on that show, and you guys need an actual wizard, you know, I don't, at this point, like, honestly, like, life's weird enough. Special things are happening. You never ever want to with your life be like, oh, please do this, please do this. Like, once you're doing that, it's like, no, that's not how it's done.
Right.
But you can totally be like, hey, Lodge 49 people, I'm an actual, you know, I actually kind of look like Doug. It's weird. Anyway, so yeah, if you guys need me, I'm honestly like, that'd be fun. We would have a great time.
Totally.
So
anyway, and it's got a Twin Peaks connection, right? We've got Kenneth Walsh who was on that show.
Exactly. And that's the thing that, you know, we do magically is like we're in film. They do magically. They put the same actors in certain places. Like a guy on The X-Files who was like set on fire became like the guy who played the Human Torch in another movie. So there's jokes like that.
Hmm.
But there's also like the power in your name and the numbers that your names form. We were talking about gematria earlier and we won't even get around to that tonight. But the number seven super is important. And you evolve through sevens. Alchemy goes through sevens. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then you're no longer on the same plane unless you go in a circle. If you spiral upwards, which I was trying to mention in the Alex Gray art again, to keep the world going, to keep the DNA going, to keep the consciousness, light of awareness going, we need to spiral upwards, and that means improving ourselves always. But the point is that, you know, you get, like, shows about Rosicrucians or Freemasons, like Lodge 49 coming out, and you just got to wonder, like, is this something that we need in our society right now so badly that the TV shows are doing it, or are they trying to write it into reality, or what?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's so cool.
It's true.
Yes.
Just write itself to reality eventually, somehow, some way.
I mean, that's the way to get to the people. I mean, so many people are like, you know, television is the only way they learn about life.
Exposes you to something different.
Do you know where it came from? The cathode ray tube and everything like that? Does one consider the source of the internet itself or even where highways came from? I mean, these things are, you know, what is the Federal Reserve doing being born on Jekyll Island? Wink. So, like, do people look at these things? And what does one understand or grok about the reality? And, you know, how big is your quote-unquote God? How big is your universe? How big are you able to be?
Right.
And ultimately, are you in service to others as much as yourself at least?
Man, Nathan Lee, this has been, like, you blow my mind tonight. This has been a great...
My last question for you.
Oh, you got one more question?
Last question. What year is it, right? Cooper's last thing.
Technically, it's the year 6020.
Ah!
What's so funny is that the York Rite actually has a different numbering system than the Masons have a different numbering system, AL. But then there's also the fact that, like, what even is the Gregorian... I was actually looking this up the other day. Been having so many weird things where, like, my life has been being revealed to me now in a way that I could never have possibly expected. So I think that's a good way to end it. And I guess I'd say also, like, to anyone who's honestly out there trying to do the good occult work and who isn't cynical and lost themselves to, like, the vampire of Abaddon, I would say that, you know, if you're not Black Lodge, if you're totally trying to be White Lodge or you are White Lodge, then feel free to reach out to me.
And how do people reach out to you? How can they follow you and find more of your work?
On your roof and yell really loud.
Nathan Lee!
Okay, what's up here? Yeah, I'll be right over it. you know what? It's like Occult Fan on Twitter is where you can find my tweetings. If you're on Discord, I have the Six of Swords Discord server. I can figure out a way to get you a link there, but occultfan@gmail.com is also acceptable. Between that and my website, occultfan.com, you'll find me. And I highly encourage you to listen to the Value for Value role-playing game, which is the way that you can donate to my show and We also have an RPG for the highest donators that month to actively play in. The money that you pay into the show, you can buy items in the game.
Cool.
And it's an actual case of when we're writing things into reality. You're already getting weird stuff with Mothman, MIB, and Interdimensionals the other night. It was like the story was writing itself, almost as if Twin Peaks itself wanted to be told in that way. Mm-hmm. So did Value role-playing game. I would love to have some Peakies in that. If you want to, Six of Swords, Apple, Podcast Addict, whatever. Most important thing is my music, Occult Fan. And got some new music in the works, which I cannot even talk about. But it's a completely separate project from Occult Fan coming up. So that's the biggest thing I'm looking forward to is my... it's like a sex worker, but I call it rock star worker.
So anyway. Nice.
Thanks for having me on, guys.
Thank you so much. It was so cool talking with you, and so a lot to you leave us with a lot to think about and a lot of homework here.
Yeah. Wow.
Well, God bless you guys, and thank you so much. I mean, like whatever God is, right? When I say God bless these days, it's like a weird oil and water thing in a way, because like I know it freaks a lot of people out today, but that's too bad.
Yeah, it's too bad.
We're disconnected. That you know, it's just, yeah. Just like, hey, everything. I love you for existing, and I don't know. I have a kind of Zen Buddhist core in a way. I just really want good, peaceful, loving things to happen.
That's a good way to live.
It really is. I wish everybody could live that way.
Yep. That's why you are a White Lodge dweller,
right?
And I think we are too, at some extent.
I believe so. To live the golden rule of treat others as you want to be treated, and
right.
Very important. I'll finish with this. I'm born on Hobbit Day.
Hobbit Day.
Oh,
that's awesome.
My life is just way too weird, and I think that's a good place to end it. Like, and thank you to David Lynch and Mark Frost. Thank you to all the Peakies out there. Peakies are the best. Thank you again to David Lynch and Mark Frost.
Oh, yeah.
It's the best.
They made an amazing world that we get to play in. We get to really dig deep. So if anybody out there has a comment, question, or theory about today's show, give us an email at twinpeaksunwrapped@gmail.com. You can follow us on Twitter @TwinPeaksUnwrapped, like us on Facebook, Twin Peaks Unwrapped, and give us that 5-star review on iTunes. We're on Spotify. We're all on major podcast places. See you guys next week.
About them. And there's a lot of safe areas.